Coming up on this episode of DL Weekly, permits issued for Spider-Man, Villainous gets a logo, annual pass holder early entrance coming to Rise of the Resistance.
Lots of Toy Story 4 characters everywhere, merch invades the cinema, and more. DL Weekly starts now.
Welcome to DL Weekly, a podcast about Walt's original Magic Kingdom, Disneyland. We cover the latest news and information from the resort, test our skills at trivia, and have a discussion about the parks every week. We invite you to send in your feedback and stories. Our contact information can be found at dlweekly.net. Now sit back, keep your hands and arms inside the podcast, and enjoy this week's show.
And welcome to this episode of DL Weekly for the week of June 19th, 2019. I'm Teg Bushman.
And I'm Teresa Urban. We would like to send a shout out and a big thank you to all of our patrons, including Trayson P, for joining us at the AP level. This support helps make DL Weekly possible. Our patrons get some pretty nice perks like access to our Discord chat, live shows, some DL Weekly swag, and more. If you'd like to learn more, head on over to dlweekly.net/supports.
Well, have you booked your trip to the resort yet? If not, you should. Contact James and Mike over at ConciEARS, and they'll take care of your entire vacation from beginning to end. And as an added bonus, you get a free year of touring plans. Why wait? Check them out at ConciEARS.com.
Just want to send a reminder to all of our annual pass holder and above patrons. This Sunday is our hangout. We do like a Google Hangout with you guys, and we're going to be discussing a movie this month. So we will give you that information in Discord to let you know which movie it is. Also, big announcement, we're having a public live stream this Sunday, 7:30 p.m. Central Time on YouTube. Please check our either Instagram, Facebook, or Twitter with the link later this week.
Yep. Well, now let's get to the news. Well, permits have been issued by the City of Anaheim for the Spider-Man attraction coming to Disney California Adventure. The permit gives us some details on the new attraction size in comparison to It's Tough to Be a Bug, which is what it's replacing. The new footprint of the attraction will be almost 40,000 square feet, or about twice the size of the previous building. Phase 1 of Marvelland is expected to open in 2020.
So, exciting news. I still want to know how this attraction is going to work. What kind of ride vehicles is I need to know more about the meat of the attraction itself. I'm happy that it's going to be bigger. Bigger's always fun. Mm-hmm. Longer attraction then. But I just really want to know what we're going to be doing once we get to be inside of the Spider-Man attraction.
So you want some excitement with this? I don't know if it's for this attraction. But I also saw online with this kind of news that they have a posting for, they want some acrobatics.
Yes, I did see that.
So I don't know if they're going to have like people swinging around outside the attraction or inside the attraction or what.
I did see that too. Thank you for reminding me. I was really excited about that and then I somehow forgot. But the other thing that I found interesting about this too is the term phase one of Marvel Land. So this whole thing with Galaxy's Edge phase one and phase two, it sounds like it's going to also be happening over in DCA. I have mixed feelings on bringing these new areas out in phases. I get it. A lot of publicity, right? And then they also don't have such a time crunch to get the whole thing done. But to me, it'd be way more exciting to visit the land in whole first instead of being able to see half of it and then having to come back to see the other part of it.
Well, I think the difference with Marvel versus Star Wars is I don't think in the beginning they were thinking that Rise of the Resistance was going to open later. I think it was, I think that they thought it was going to open all at the same time. With Marvel, I think it's different because I think you're going to get this Spider-Man attraction and there's like a brewery and stuff that they're going to have also in there. And then I think phase two is going to be more taking over more back lot. Taking up more stuff in that area.
So kind of phase one is the Bugs Land area.
Yes.
And then phase two is beyond Bugs Land.
Yeah, that's what I think anyway.
Okay. But we'll find out.
Yeah.
The logo for the new Halloween World of Color show has been released. The new show, called Villainous, will tell the tale of a young girl who is a new character for this show named Shelley Marie. She's trying to make a decision on her Halloween costume and wondering if she could be as strong as some of her favorite villains. Villains include the Queen, Ursula, Dr. Facilier, Hades, Jafar, and Maleficent. The logo features Oogie Boogie and Shelley Marie with the Villainous title below, with the saying, "Deep down, there's a little villain in all of us."
I am excited at the fact that we finally have something that's villain-centered over here, because they've had that over in Magic Kingdom and Disney World for a while. They've had, you know, the Hocus Pocus stage show. I will say, I do see a lack of Hocus Pocus characters here, which I really enjoy. But I do like this. I feel like they're actually putting a little bit more effort into this one because they're actually creating a character for the show.
Yeah.
So it's not just like a bunch of clips of things put together mm-hmm. with music and mm-hmm. water and light, which can be good, but I feel like they're actually going with like a storyline here.
It'll be, I can't wait. I'm trying to figure out how I could possibly make it again.
I feel like you say this every week.
I do. How I could possibly make it out to the parks again to be able to see this, because you, the only time you can see this is if you have tickets to the Oogie Boogie Bash. So yeah. I really want to see it. I really want to go. And yes, I know that I could watch a video online, but it is not the same. It is not the same at all.
No, especially those nighttime spectaculars, things like Fantasmic, things like the fireworks, things like World of Color. It doesn't really do it justice in a video. As we reported on last week, the pedestrian bridge over Magic Way was lifted into place Friday night. There's still a lot of work to be done on the ramp down from the bridge, but rumor has it they're shooting for a July 1st opening date for the structure, with the bridge opening in September.
Ooh, just around the corner.
So this will almost be open by when we're there in late August, but I'm just glad that the parking structure will be open when we're there, because you know me and the parking structure.
and then you can go ride the tram.
Soon enough, we will know all of the secrets of the parking ramp, and I will be excited.
With all the details coming out of Disney World regarding the previews for annual pass holders for their version of Galaxy's Edge, there is a rumor floating around that if all goes well, the same could be coming for Phase 2 of Disneyland's Galaxy's Edge. Phase 2 is, of course, the Rise of the Resistance attraction that is slated to open later this year.
So I saw rumors this week, and I got really excited by one rumor and really disappointed by another rumor.
A roller coaster of...
One rumor said that they thought that Rise of the Resistance was scheduled to open in August, which made me extremely excited.
Oh, sure, yes.
But then it was immediately countered by someone who said they talked to cast members and they're having trouble with the trackless ride system and they're looking at November. And we've had some people in our chat, too, guess November was probably going to be when it happens.
Or early December.
Yeah.
We were thinking in lines with the new movie.
Right.
When the new movie was going to be released.
So I'm a little bummed about that. But back to this story, you know, they're going to do this thing where annual pass holders can get in. So it's going to be like how Disneyland opened with reservations and all that. Although people are calling out that they should do that as well. Annual pass holders at Disneyland will be able to go in and see Rise of the Resistance first, so kind of be another soft opening for that, and it's kind of a nice thing for annual pass holders.
I read this as instead of doing a press preview, they were going to open that. So you're thinking it's the instead of doing reservations, it's just going to be annual pass holders for the first month or something?
That's what Disney has announced.
Okay.
They haven't announced any type of reservation system yet. But people online are hoping that they do that because it has worked out so well at Disneyland.
Yeah. See, when I read preview, I thought like the night before it opened.
No, so this is supposed to be, so the one in Disney World opens on August 31st. They're saying that these previews would start on August 7th and go through the 31st.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So we'll see how it is. This sounds like a great deal. However, the exact same time they announced this, they also announced that a bunch of the annual passes that are valid for this, their prices went up by triple digits.
Ooh.
So they went, in a lot of cases, they went up $150 or more.
Ouch.
So the same thing that we had at Disneyland a couple years ago,
it's
now hitting Disney World. Which reminds me, I know this is a Disneyland podcast, but another thing about prices, they also announced that they raised their parking prices at Disney World, too. So all their prices at Disney World are going up.
This is how they're softening the blow.
Sure.
You can see Galaxy's Edge early.
With a lot of this money. Just after recording last week's episode of the podcast, Disney released some information on the meet and greet that has now appeared at Pixar Pier. The new meet and greet is with Bo Peep from the new Toy Story movie. Yeah. So there is a ton of Toy Story stuff coming out this week. This is kind of the Toy Story block we're getting into.
Yeah, because it comes out this week.
Right, right. And already. I guess it was the same thing when we had Aladdin. There was a bunch of Aladdin stuff. Yes. So, okay.
So I don't know. I've never personally seen Bo Peep as a meet and greet character before when she was in her nice dress. But now this Bo Peep is the new version of Bo Peep. This is the BA version of Bo Peep. It's where she's got, no longer does she have the dress. She's got her crook is like her power staff and she's got her hair pulled back. She's ready for action. So, but
she looks a little creepy.
Well, she's a porcelain doll. You have to remember that. She does.
Porcelain dolls are creepy.
She doesn't, to me, she doesn't look like the most friendly character. I know the big Jessie statue in front of the Critter Carousel was getting a little flack for being creepy looking. To me, Bo Peep's a little bit more unsettling. But she's a porcelain doll, so how else? I mean, she couldn't be a face character. So,
yeah.
I mean, I get it. They did what they... That's the best that they could do with the character.
That was my first thought, was why isn't it a face character? But you're absolutely right. It has to look like a porcelain doll, and nobody's going to look like a porcelain doll.
No.
But I don't know. Are you excited to meet Bo Peep?
I'm not excited about Bo Peep. I'm excited about a different character that we're going to talk about later.
Okay, well, let's keep moving along then.
Well, starting June 21st, some treats inspired by Toy Story 4 will be available to enjoy for a limited time at the resort. First up, there is the Carnival Cake, which is a funnel cake topped with fruity cereal milk, whipped cream, and raspberry sauce. The Loop de Loop is a sundae made with vanilla ice cream topped with strawberry and raspberry sauce, and it also has a fruity cereal churro. And then there's also Bonnie's Root Beer Float. That's a little bit different take on a classic summer treat. It's actually made with Sprite, blue cotton candy ice cream, and topped with cotton candy. So you can head on over to the Golden Horseshoe Saloon to check these out.
I like this idea of kind of like a root beer float with Sprite.
Sugar. That's all. What, like, all I thought when I was like reading about these things was sugar, sugar, and more sugar. Hmm. You think the quote-unquote root beer float sounds good?
I didn't say it sounded good. I thought it was interesting that they did Sprite. Like, I never thought about doing that.
It is an interesting take. It seems like that's the one that just kills me with the sugar. That's a lot of sugar for me.
You don't think that the one that's the fruity cereal? I mean, that looks sounds like a lot.
That's the one I would go for, was the loop-de-loop sundae.
Yeah, that's the one I would go for,
that's
too.
That's the one I would go for. That seems the least sugary.
I guess I was thinking
options.
About the funnel fried cake. Funnel topped with the cereal. That was going to be too much for me. Although it does look like they brought back that like Toy Story boot.
Yeah, so the photos of Bonnie's Root Beer Float is in the Woody boot that they had during Pixar Fest with, what was it called, Boot Beer Float, I think is what they called it.
Because you got one of those, didn't you?
I did, and it even has Andy's name on the bottom. I love it. So
you have that with your other memorabilia?
It is. It's on display in my house. But yeah, so that's exciting to me about this new Root Beer Float. But the rest of it, it sounds like a stomach ache for me.
Yeah.
I'm curious, though, because I do think Sprite with a cotton candy ice cream might be an interesting flavor for like one bite. I couldn't do the whole thing.
We might have to, if it's still there when we're there, we might have to do one and then hope that everybody else in our group drinks the rest of it. Is this who you're talking about?
This is who I'm talking about. This is who I'm so excited about.
Forky has made his way to Pixar Pier. All sorts of Forky-themed merchandise can be found at Knickknacks. We've seen T-shirts, mugs, and plushes featuring the new character. Guests can get their photo taken with Forky, too. He can be found just outside the shop. Didn't we have a listener send us, like, a picture?
We did. He showed up over the weekend, and one of our listeners sent a very cute photo of her daughter with Forky. He's, you know, I don't know anything about this character. I'm totally judging him based on his looks. Mm-hmm. He looks so adorable. Horrible to me. So I'm very excited. I hope he doesn't let me down in the film. I know there are there's mixed reviews. Some people think, oh gosh, he's all over the place. He's going to be, you know, this is already obnoxious. We don't even know this character and he's all over the parks. I think he's adorable. So I've got my fingers crossed that he's a very lovable character.
He's cute. From what I've seen from the previews and what I've gathered, it sounds to me like he is a toy because you create him and he becomes a toy, right? Like a toy could be anything that a kid plays with. And he doesn't feel
he's having an
like
identity
a toy.
Crisis.
Yeah. Because he's like cutlery or something. Like he doesn't feel like he fits in with everybody else.
And worse than that, he's not a fork. He's not a spoon. He's kind of somewhere in between. So he's having all sorts of identity crises, I think.
Spork. I wonder why they didn't call him Sporky.
Maybe we'll figure that out in the movie. Maybe he really wants to be a fork.
Is Spork, this is really a silly question, but is Spork like a trademarked term? Like, does some company own the term Spork?
I don't know. I wouldn't think so.
Oh, it just makes me think about the Sporks that aren't in Galaxy's Edge anymore because people were terrible.
Well, last week, in a move that has angered a lot of the community, Disney installed some merchandise tables in the Main Street Cinema. The reason that guests are not happy is that this is one of the very few places on Main Street that isn't a merchandise location, and it's still pretty close to what it was when the park opened back in 1955. Adding items for sale here is thought as a cash grab. Disney has responded that it was an attempt to draw guests into the space that many passed up. Interesting. I see both sides here. I originally was on the fence of, really? Why are you putting more things? You know, you don't have enough retail space. You're going to take over the cinema as well. But it's hard for me to argue with them trying to draw more people in there, because I do think it is a place, especially on Main Street, that a lot of people overlook and don't ever actually go into. I know there were people that I had seen last time we were there. They didn't realize that there was anything in there. They thought it was just a facade, and it was just the front of the other, you know, because there's, you know, the big stores that are just kind of connected. They thought it was a facade and there was merchandise behind it. It would be interesting. I would like if they put like benches in there and made it a little bit more inviting to hang out.
That's what some people were saying, is that one of the things is you go in there to watch some of these shorts that are playing, and there's nowhere to sit down, so you have to stand up in there. And it's a great place for air conditioning during the hot summer and everything. So they were saying, you know, maybe they should put some theater-style seating or even just some benches in there instead of merchandise. And some people were saying, too, especially with the new Mickey shorts, that they should play some of those in there instead of...
Switch them out.
I saw a number, and I don't know if this is accurate, so I'm going to say it on the podcast, but I'm going to preface it with saying, I don't know if this is accurate, but somebody said the videos they've been playing there have not changed in, like, 40 years. Like, it's the same videos. Sure. So, of course, people aren't being drawn in to look at it. It's the same thing for, like, 40 years. So, swap some different things out. Maybe even do... Somebody was saying that there's some 3D shorts. Maybe do one of the screens as 3D or something. That could be pretty cool. I don't really go in there that often. I think I popped in there with James when we went, just because, you know, being to Disneyland for the first time, we should go check it out. But it's not like something, you know, I'm one of those people, I would go in there to get the air conditioning and whatever.
Kind of recharge.
Yeah, but it wasn't, you know, it's a cool space. And to be honest with you, I'm really surprised that it's lasted this long without being cannibalized into merchandise.
That is true. The one thing... If I had a suggestion...
Maybe Kim Irvine is like, don't touch it.
If I had a suggestion for it, the one thing I would like to see, if it maybe only... To me, there's too many screens, and I get distracted, and I don't know which one I need to choose to watch. Because I get excited, like, ooh, what's happening over there? Ooh, but over here, too. So it's a little distracting for me with with multiple screens. So maybe if they had one or two screens instead, and they were larger with seating, maybe that'd be more inviting.
That's a good thought. I'm trying to think of, like, because the whole idea is it's kind of a circle.
Yeah.
So I'm trying to think, like, okay, so if you have two screens, what would you do with the rest of the space?
Well, you could have two screens, one on the left side, one on the right side, and you can make them bigger, and you can almost, like, curve them. So it's like you're in the cartoon. That's my thought.
That could be cool.
And then incorporate those 3D films in there, then you're really there in the short.
Yeah. I feel like there's definitely something that could be done here. You know, if they want to put a merchandise location there, you know what they could do? Because that center section is kind of like an elevated, like, platform in the middle. They can make it kind of movie theater like, and they could put like a popcorn stand in there.
Oh, there you go.
Because that would bring people in, and it would still fit with the cinema theme.
Lots to clean up though, so poor cast members having to sweep out the cinema.
Well, they have to anyway. But yeah, I mean, you know. Well, some new treats can be found over at the Jolly Holiday. There's a colorful Goofy-themed cookie and milk macaron. The classic macaron is filled with edible cookie dough and a milk panna cotta. Well, this sounds good. next is the Steamboat Willie cupcake, made with pound cake, topped with a light cheesecake-flavored frosting, and filled with a berry filling. I did read some reviews on this, and they said that they thought that the pound cake was kind of dry. Unfortunately, I love pound cake. There's also a Tinkerbell-themed coconut cheesecake with white chocolate wings. And finally, a spin on two classics, a s'mores brownie piled high with chocolate, toasted marshmallows, and graham cracker pieces. Anything that's a s'more sounds great.
So It's interesting, the review you read, because I was looking at the Disney food blogs, mm-hmm. and of course, Disney food blog, they were reviewing all of these. They were disappointed with the macaron, and they were disappointed with the coconut cheesecake. I did find it kind of a little ironic, because they said it was too, like, if you like coconut, you'd like this cheesecake, but for them, it was too coconutty. And they did say that the macaron, the cookie, the edible cookie dough part was really good, but they weren't a big fan of the milk panna cotta. They did say that the pound cake was good. They didn't say that that was dry. So maybe
it's just
depends on when you get it, I guess. Yeah. And they were really excited about the s'mores brownie.
I'm just excited looking at the size of this goofy macaron.
I love the colors. I love the colors.
I like the colors,
so
but it's so large. Like, that's like the size of like four macarons.
Have you had a Disneyland macaron before?
No.
They're not messing around.
No.
They're like.
No, but when we go, I'm going to have all
the Disney
macarons.
You're going to have
all of them.
And then you're going to have a stomach ache because you don't realize how many there are. There's so many macarons.
Between the macarons and the churros, it's going to be a problem.
And then your cotton candy float thing that you want to try too. Yeah. Bonnie's root beer float.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
You're going to be on a sugar high and then a sugar crash. So you'll have to recharge in the cinema. Stephen Miller, the creative lead on merchandising that focuses on attractions and all the colored ears like rose gold, is leaving Disneyland after 10 years of service. Although he's leaving Disneyland, he is staying in the Disney family, just moving up to a higher position over at Walt Disney World. Stephen started as a skipper at Disney World on the Seven Seas Lagoon. Much like Kim Irvine, he believes strongly in the Walt way of things around the park. So, whoever's going to take his position, very big shoes to fill.
Mm-hmm.
Very big. I think that's so cool that he started as a skipper mm-hmm. and worked up to the head of merchandising.
Yeah, so for me, it's kind of cool because we're learning more and more, it seems like recently, of these people like Kim Irvine,
yes,
Steve Miller. That are really like a lot of our favorites that we've seen. Mm-hmm. You know, like the attraction, mm-hmm. a lot of the attraction stuff lately, I've really liked. The colored ears, whatever. I it's not my thing, but people love him. You know, so I like that. I'm kind of sad that he's leaving Disneyland because, you know,
the merchandise
he's doing great work.
Recently, I feel, has been very well done. Mm-hmm. I haven't been disappointed by too many merchandise related things recently, which is a problem because then I just want to buy it all. So maybe it's a little better for
you're
going to
go
wallet.
Broke.
I'm going to go broke. You're going to have the world's worst stomach ache.
I'm
Welcome
also
to
gonna
our
go
trip
broke.
To Disneyland.
I'm also going to go broke. Although I did look, there was an article today that they listed all of the merchandise they're going to have at D23, and they had pictures and prices.
Oh, no.
And I found myself not really that excited about a lot of the merchandise.
Oh, good. So
I
we'll
felt
save a
good.
Little money there.
I do want a D23 shirt, but that's all. Well, the S'mores Churro has returned to the resort. Oh, I'm so excited for this. The churro is covered in crushed graham crackers and served with gooey chocolate and marshmallow toppings. Pick one up at the churro cart located across from the Haunted Mansion.
Perfect. So you can go ride my favorite attraction and then try this awesome sounding dessert.
It does sound really
I'm
good.
Jealous. I'm jealous we can't be there soon because I feel like this is probably not going to stick around long enough for us to be able to try it in a couple of months, but it looks delicious.
Hope so. I'm just thinking like, because it looks like they have like this whip, or not whipped cream, this like marshmallow
yeah,
kind
marshmallow
of thing with chocolate in the middle, and you can like dip it.
And it's gooey.
Mm-hmm. I wonder if it's like a marshmallow cream, because I can't imagine that it's like super hot. I mean, I guess it could be. I'm intrigued.
On June 14th, three iconic attractions celebrated their 60th anniversaries in the park. The Disneyland Allweg Monorail, now just the Disneyland Monorail, the Matterhorn Bobsleds, and the Submarine Voyage all opened on the same day with the expanded Tomorrowland. There was a photo op set up next to the Matterhorn Fastpass distribution to commemorate the occasion. We will talk a lot more about these attractions later on in our discussion topic today.
I was very sad that I was not there for this photo op because
it was a very cool photo op.
It was like in front of like an e-ticket with the thing and you could hold them. And like, I don't know. I was just very, very excited by this kind of photo op. And of course, I like all these attractions. I love them. Of course, everybody knows I love the monorail.
You do?
Yeah. The Matterhorn bobsleds we've
More
talked about.
More than People Mover?
Oh, that's a hard one.
Ooh.
I don't know. It depends, I guess. And then, of course, the Submarine Voyage, which, funny enough, people on our forums have all ticketed the Submarine Voyage as, like, the worst attraction at the resort right now.
Yeah. If I had to choose one to go, that would, unfortunately, that would be the one. So it's very sad to me that it's been around technically it's been around for 6 years. As we all know, it was closed for quite a period of time before it became kind of was revitalized and became Nemo's. I'm very happy that the Matterhorn and that the monorail are getting to celebrate 60 years. I'm not sure if it's fair to put the subs in the same category since they were closed for, what, 10 years?
Yeah, at least. Yeah.
So, but I mean, it had the same, technically they did have the same opening day. They just haven't been operational for the full period of time.
That's true. I could see where you're going with that. But I think it's just the whole idea that these three attractions that open at the same day, the same year, are still there in some form.
That's true.
But I agree with you. I don't think the subs, I don't know. What do you guys think? Do you guys think that that the subs should be counted as a 60th anniversary of them? Like, is the fact that they were just sitting there good enough for you? Or is it, does it have to be operating for most of that time and be kind of the same thing and not be shut down for an extended period? Because, I mean, the Matterhorn's been shut down quite a bit. The monorail was shut down when they were doing California Adventure construction. So, I mean, nothing, I think, in the park has been 60 years.
No.
But.
Well, now we take a trip to Trivia Land where producer James tries to stump us with some Disney trivia. He's going to read us some questions. We're going to try and answer them. And then he will give us the correct answers after our discussion topic. So what do you have for us this week, James?
Well, I have a new kind of question for you this week.
Oh, boy. I was going to ask for him to be nice. We'll see what happens.
This is from a listener, if I remember right.
It is. Dylan H. has provided me with an audio clip from Attraction Somewhere in the Resort. It's up to you to tell me which attraction it's from.
Ooh.
Oh, this is kind of exciting. I like this.
Yes.
So that last part made me think carousel, so I'm going to say carousel, because it sounded organ-y.
Yeah.
So that's my guess. It's the King Arthur's Carousel.
I don't think it's the carousel. It's something in Fantasyland, for sure.
Do you know what it sounded like to me?
The Casey Jr.? That's my guess.
You know what it sounded like to me? Is it sounded like...
We're probably on the way other opposite end of where this is. It's probably in DCA. It sounds so dang familiar.
It reminded me of the music they used to play when they did, like, when they had, like, the Disneyland TV show, and they just have, like, music playing in the background while they showed pictures of attractions.
Yeah.
But not actual attraction music, but it is an attraction.
It is an attraction.
It reminded me, for some reason, I was reminded of Peter Pan. I don't think that's it, but it made me feel like I should be, like, soaring over something.
Sure.
I don't know. Right. I have a strong feeling of Fantasyland.
Oh, which is,
who knows?
Well, I do.
James knows. And Dylan knows. Casey Jr., final answer. Okay. Otherwise, I'm just going to keep talking myself into other things.
Sure.
All right, for question number two, I'm lost in the park again. Can you find me?
Oh, no.
I hopped on the Disneyland Railroad from the main entrance and almost completed the full circuit tour. But I was afraid to see the primeval world, so I got off before it. I walked west, thankful I wasn't stuck in all that traffic to my right. I took my first left, kept walking, but I wasn't ready for another adventure, so I decided to pit stop for some food. Where am I eating?
Oh, you're eating at the Tomorrowland Terrace, I think it's what it was called at one time.
Oh, yeah, what's that called?
The Tomorrowland Terrace.
Yeah.
But I think...
Like it's Ray's, that's all I remember.
But I thought that they...
Across from the subs.
Yeah. Are you saying Tomorrowland Terrace?
Yes, I'm also saying the Terrace.
But I feel like it's... They changed the name of it or something.
Is it a restaurant or is it a food cart?
It's a restaurant.
Okay.
It is a physical building.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's the Tomorrowland Terrace. Okay. I mean, probably. Every time I say that, it ends up not being what it is.
I told you I'm lost somewhere, so clearly need the help.
You know, it's okay, James. I get a little afraid of the primeval world too myself. It's intense.
It is. All right, our third question is a two-parter, and it comes from listener Jeremy J. So in honor of June being Pride Month, at the Disney parks, there's unofficial gay days.
Mm-hmm.
How long has the event been running at Disneyland?
Ooh.
And why are participants encouraged to wear red?
Ooh.
Well, they're encouraged to wear... Okay, now I think there's alternative. Well, one of the reasons you're encouraged to wear red is so people can see who's there for the event and supporting gay days.
I would also say it's a AIDS awareness.
But I think
color.
It's also AIDS mm-hmm. awareness. But I haven't heard that recently, but
it's been going on for a while. Has it been 25 years is my guess.
I'm going to say, because it was going when we were there, I think it had a 10th. I'm going to say it's 2001 it started.
So 18. And I'm
sure. And then I'm going to say, because I can't say both the things I said, right? I can't say that it's to be part of the thing and AIDS thing.
I will double check if both are correct, but I only have one answer.
Okay. But if I say both, that's kind of cheating, right?
Because that's like, probably cheating.
Okay, so I'll go with the AIDS thing too. Why not? All right.
All right, and our last question this week. Apparently, we're in a musical mood. It comes from Ryan H. Ryan wants to know which Disney Pixar film features a soundtrack clip from The Haunted Mansion. If you need a second hint, yes. I'm ready to give this one.
Yeah, what's the second hint?
It's very subtly in the background when a character is having a creepy dream.
Oh.
Is it Inside Out?
That's what I'm going to say. Are you saying Inside Out?
I'm saying Inside Out.
Is that all?
Yeah. So we'll see if they hit the right note after this week's discussion topic.
I will say that I enjoyed this week because it was a good mixture of
that
different
was.
Things because you had the music, which actually I think that's a really nice addition to trivia.
Super clever, Dylan.
And then
clever.
Yep, and then finding where we were, and then so digging it.
This week we are going to discuss the Matterhorn, the monorail, and the submarine, since they all just celebrated their 60th anniversaries this past weekend. I know we've already gone in depth on a couple of these, but we figured why not pay them a little respect since they have been standing and been giving us so much excitement for so long. It's real. I don't know why, but it's mind-boggling to me to think that it's been 60 years. Just crazy.
Well, it's strange because for some reason I feel like it was just the park 60th anniversary, and I forget that these things have been there
pretty
for
much
so long.
Yeah,
you know, it's only a 4-year difference.
Beginning. Yep.
Which one do you want to start with?
Let's talk about the subs.
Sure. So the submarine voyage, of course, has been around since 1959, June 14th.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to say this right now off the bat. Every time I'm waiting for the monorail and I look down into the water, it looks so refreshing.
You just want to.
I want to jump in it.
I'm very impressed with how clean they keep this water.
Definitely.
It's crystal clear. Which is amazing to me because sometimes when I'm in the sub and I'm riding it, looking out, the water doesn't look as nice and crystal clear as it does
no.
when you're looking across the lagoon.
Well, I think that's because you're looking through some of the,
yeah, the
plexiglass
the
stuff and everything.
Mm-hmm. So the submarine voyage was originally a little bit different than, quite a lot of bit different than what it is today. It was actually themed to the USS Nautilus historic trip around the North Pole. So this was kind of like 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea-esque.
Right.
So a little bit different than our fun little clownfish that we get to follow around today.
Mm-hmm.
It was the first of its kind of any theme park. So I think that's kind of important. I don't know if there's really anything similar that I can think of either. It's a very unique attraction.
They do have an attraction that just opened, I want to say at SeaWorld in Florida, that I've seen people that, you know, cover all the different theme parks talk about, and they were saying that they wish Disney would have done this for Finding Nemo Submarine Voyage, because instead of putting the subs physically underwater, the way that this particular one works is they put a layer of water in between the glass, and so it feels like, so you see the bubbles and all the stuff moving, but it's going through basically a dry track.
But how would that work? You can't do that with the lagoon, though.
No, but
you'd have to be in a show building.
Yeah, you'd have to have a show building, but you also, it's a lot easier to maintain when it's not a bunch of
that. You know, but there's something more interesting and magical about the fact that you're actually getting into a sub, getting into the water, as ridiculous as it sounds. I still have to lean a little bit forward in my seat and look up from my little porthole, because they do a great job making you feel like you've actually
descended
and that you're, you know, further down. Me as an adult woman, I still feel and get the sense that that I've somehow plunged to the depths below, and I have to kind of check myself and, you know, peek up and look. Oh, yep, nope. There's the actual water line. We haven't actually moved it. It is really cool how they do that.
So this is interesting. So they are not actual submarines, like you said. They do not actually submerge, mm-hmm. But they are in fact boats. Where originally they held 38 passengers, they now hold 40 passengers, and the seating area for the passengers are below the water level. So there are 8 of these vehicles, and it's been called one of the world's largest peacetime submarine fleets. Each of these cost $80,000 to build. Dang. And were fabricated at Todd Shipyards in San Pedro, California, which is actually a big port. And then transported to the Disneyland Naval Yards in Anaheim for outfitting under the direction of retired Admiral Joe Fowler, which I don't know how many people know this or if you know this, Teresa, but Joe Fowler was actually one of the people that was responsible for making sure that Disney World, the property and stuff, was prepared for Disney World.
Sure.
He oversaw construction of Disneyland and Disney World. So that's pretty cool.
So the original attraction also... there were some very classic elements to that attraction. Some of these, there are still little Easter eggs, if you will, or little pieces of the original attraction.
Little nods to the past.
Yep. So one of the big things was the giant squid.
Oh, I loved the giant squid.
He was probably the iconic yep. thing about the attraction. They also had mermaids for a while. They had real actresses mm-hmm. sitting out in the lagoon, sunning themselves. There was all sorts of kind of funny mishaps with that. They had issues with
Men jumping in.
They had issues with the mermaid's hair because of all the chlorine mm-hmm. and keeping color. Those poor girls. They weren't paid enough. I don't care what it was that they right. were paid, but they definitely were not paid enough. There was ancient ruins of lost lands that you kind of explored as well. But then there was also that cute little sea serpent dragon thing. I feel like he should have a nickname.
Oh, the really silly, like, googly eye thing.
Yes, that I believe mm-hmm. they just sold in the
auction
last yeah. year that was up in California. He was a funky little dude.
Yeah.
Now, I shouldn't say little. He was pretty big.
He's cool, though. So when the attraction originally opened, it looked more kind of realistic to, like, an actual naval fleet. Mm-hmm. So it was painted in a military gray with black lower hulls, and it stayed that way till 1986, which actually I didn't realize it stayed gray that long. I thought it was a little bit not that long before they changed it to yellow, which with white around the periscope towers, along with a pastel blue or pastel pink trim on the hatch doors, periscope tower or lower hull. There was an issue with this. They had to be repainted because it started peeling right away. And then it was replaced with a mustard yellow along with orange and black trim, and it would stay that color until 1998. Of course, the yellow color made it look more like a research sub instead of like military mm-hmm, sub. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, it got repainted again when it reopened as Finding Nemo Submarine Voyage, and that's the color we have today, which is more of a bright yellow, you know, to kind of go along with, the Finding Nemo kind of brighter color scheme. Now, the original submarine names from 1959 to 1986 were the Nautilus, the Seawolf, the Skate, the Skipjack, the Triton, the George Washington, the Patrick Henry, and the Ethan Allen. And then when it switched over to the yellow color, they became the Exploration Submarine. And those names were the Nautilus, the Neptune, the Sea Star, the Explorer, the Seeker, the Argonaut, the Triton, and the Seawolf. So there were some that kept their name, and there were others that that their name changed to kind of go along with that.
So to kind of give you guys a timeline, we kind of talked about this earlier. The original submarine voyage did close in 1998. Finding Nemo Submarine Voyage, however, did not open again until 2007. It was June 11th, 2007. I almost wish they would have waited until the 14th. That would have mm-hmm. been nice. But anyways,
right.
So it was almost 10 years that this poor lagoon just sat. That's really shocking to me.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, this was a very big investment. It was unlike anything any other theme park had, really. So I get why they kind of held off on it. For a time, they had talked about theming it to Atlantis.
Yep.
I think that was a great movie. Talk about underrated Disney movies, which we're going to talk more about. If you guys are a patron of ours, supporter at the annual pass holder level or above, we're going to be doing a monthly get together that we all watch a movie beforehand and we discuss it. I'm really excited to go with the lesser known movies because I think they're great. Mm-hmm. Hidden gems. Atlantis is one of them. So anyways, but I do think they made the right pick because Finding Nemo was incredibly popular mm-hmm. for quite a while when it came out. That came out in 2003. So they waited a couple of years to get it themed. But
right.
So yeah, it's amazing to me that it sat empty for that long. There are they've got pieces of glass in the paint that they use in the lagoon to mm-hmm. paint the coral so that they catch the sun and reflect a bit.
It does look beautiful.
It is. It does look, especially if you're on it after it's freshly been painted and they've freshly done things, it looks great. Very difficult to keep the colors vibrant for long though, because it is Southern California and they are just out in this baking in the sun all
day. And water damages everything too.
Yep, and water. Plus I'm sure there's chlorine mm-hmm. in there so they don't get any things growing on them.
Well, speaking of the lagoon, I feel like we need to talk about this. So the lagoon that houses the attraction holds 9 million gallons.
Just the lagoon?
Yes.
Wow.
9 million gallons. There has been rumors that I remember reading online, and I just want to make sure that you guys know that this is not true. If you think about it later on, there was concern and rumors back when the submarine voyage closed in 1998, when it was sitting empty and they did not do anything, people mm-hmm. were wondering why they didn't drain it.
Sure.
Because they were saying that it leaks really bad, which is true. It was a lot of leaking back then. And so they were spending a ton of money just to keep it full. So they were wondering,
why are they keeping
it full? Why don't they drain it? Why don't they try to do something with it? And the rumor was, which is not true, that they were saying that the water provides enough weight against the base of the Matterhorn, because they were saying that if you drained the lagoon, the Matterhorn would sink into the ground.
Oh my.
So was not true, because when they drained it to do Finding Nemo,
ta-da, the Matterhorn did not sink.
But I thought that was a fun piece of information to talk
about.
Very
interesting. Oh, hang on. I do see here, remember how we were talking about those poor mermaids were not paid enough. They were paid $1.65 an hour. Which in current terms, if this was 2018, that would be about $13.15 an hour. That's
respectable.
Awful, not terrible. That's better than I was thinking it would be. So still not great. I feel like they dealt with a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And they were out in the sun all day and had to deal with people trying to swim out to them and all the fumes from the chlorine and all that.
Well, just so imagine having to sit out there in the sun. You don't have shade.
That's a long day. That's a very long day.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I guess it's nice so you can, like, put your feet in. I wonder how good their, like, sunscreen and stuff was back then, because I feel like you'd get burnt.
Yeah, they probably had, like, shifts or something. They were only out there, like, an hour or two at a time. You know, this is...
Did they have to swim out there?
I don't know.
Yeah.
They would have had to have. How else would they have gotten? Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not like they just had a crane and plopped them down on their rock.
And there wasn't, like, a bridge out there.
Yeah. So this is really ridiculous. And for some reason, this is one of the attractions. It's probably very simple. But this attraction boggles my brain a little bit.
Okay.
So I know when you're in the lagoon that you're underwater, obviously. Yep. But once you enter the show building, I cannot tell if there's water or not, because some of those screens
mm-hmm.
are so dang clear that I just can't believe that I'm looking through water to see the projections on the screens. This is an attraction that I would love to have an on-show exit for, because I would love to see
the show building. Yeah.
Yeah, they exit you out if they have to evacuate.
So I actually saw pictures from, I saw pictures that cast members have taken inside the show building,
mm-hmm.
and in the building there's water, and there's just like
it's
a...
It's crazy to me. Like
a catwalk over
it. I feel like that's not true.
Well, one of these days you'll have to
figure it out. It's got to be more magical than that.
Yeah, see, here's the catwalk, here's the water, here's the thing.
Yeah, it's crazy to me. I really did not think the show building had water in it. I thought that somehow...
Oh, you're right, evacuating the submarine voyage.
I thought that somehow there was no water in the show building, and they just still made it appear that you were underwater, and the only time that the sub was actually in water was when you were in the lagoon.
Can we talk about this really quick? So this was a post on the Disneyland subreddit from 7 months ago that somebody had a picture of this,
mm-hmm.
and... I feel like you're going to love the top comment on this, which was, I've always wanted this to happen to me.
Oh, Yeah, no, I wouldn't want to stop in the middle of the lagoon. That sounds like a like claustrophobic nightmare to be right? stuck in the sub and not be able to get out.
No, that would thank be, you. That would be terrible. So let's move on. So that's the submarine voyage. So let's move on to the Matterhorn. Now, we actually just did an episode about the Matterhorn
not too long ago.
So we go really in depth there. We're just going to kind of give a quick overview here. So the area where the Matterhorn was built back when the park was open was it was the dirt. They actually took the dirt out of the moat and put it on this little hill. And for a while, it became, I believe, Holiday Hill is what they called it at one point. There were some people that nicknamed it different things because they would go up there and, you know, teenagers would climb to the top of it and make out and stuff. And Disney didn't really like that. And, you know, family friendly of the 50s. Mm-hmm. So they decided to build the Matterhorn there.
Very cool. I feel like this is a very well-known fact. If you're going to know one thing about the Matterhorn, it is this. It was the first thrill ride at Disneyland, but it was also the first roller coaster ever to use tubular steel for its track. So All of the roller coaster enthusiasts, it's a big deal for them to go visit the Matterhorn since it was the first of its kind. But it's very cool. I enjoy it. I know it has nicknames of it kind of being like the Batterhorn.
It is
a little rough in some spots, and sometimes your ride vehicle does not, I don't know, hold you in place as well as maybe you feel it should. But I feel like that's what's thrilling about it. You're not actually in danger, but sometimes when you kind of feel like you're gonna, I don't know, fly out of your ride vehicle, your bobsled. But it's
Like the older ride things where like where basically there was no separation between you and the other person you were in your bobsled with, because it allowed you to kind of get a little cuddly with people. And I felt like, I don't know, I liked it better. And I think people complained less of being rammed around in it because of that, for whatever reason. Now, one of the reasons that this was built the way it was built was it was intended to also act as a decorative overlay to camouflage the central pylon of the Skyway. So it's let's make this a multifunction thing. Let's get rid of the hill that all the people are making out on. Let's put an attraction on it, and let's make it.
And we have to hide this post.
Yeah. So, you know, you got to give it to them for creativity. That's for sure. So the idea came from Disney's extended vacation, Walt Disney's extended vacation in Switzerland while filming Third Man on the Mountain. So,
and rumor has it, he fell in love with, so the Matterhorn, there is a real Matterhorn. It does not just exist in Disneyland.
Yep.
There is a real Matterhorn in Switzerland. And Walt fell in love with it, and he purchased a postcard with the Matterhorn on it, sent it back to his Imagineers with just the little short phrase, build this. I love that. I hope maybe somewhere in the Disney archives that postcard still exists.
That would be awesome.
The build this, I want it. Make it happen.
Well, I mean, if you're Walt Disney, why not?
I guess.
So obviously part of this to make it look big. I'll tell you what, we were talking about height here in a second. And when I was younger and we would go to Disneyland, the Matterhorn was like one of the tallest things around.
Yeah.
So that was the first thing I'd see at Disneyland, and I know I had arrived. So one of the things that makes it look taller than it actually is just like on Main Street with the Sleeping Beauty Castle and all the buildings on Main Street, and actually in most of the park, it uses forced perspective. So waterfalls cascade down its side, frequently sprayed riders. They do smaller trees as you go up the mountain and smaller trees. Mm-hmm. And in fact, another cool thing that they don't really do anymore, but I kind of wish they did because I think it's kind of cool, is they used to have people that actually scaled the mountain.
Yes, yes.
And Mickey used to scale the mountain, too.
I remember one of my first trips to Disneyland and seeing that. I didn't know that was a thing. All of a sudden, I look up on this mountain, and here's Mickey in his, like, mountain climbing outfit making his way up to the peak. I was just amazed. I remember we were in Fantasyland, and we just stood there and like stared up and watched it with our jaws to the floor, like, what?
Very cool. I also missed the Skyway going through the Matterhorn because it was kind of a cool way to see that attraction because you literally go through it. And then, of course, one of the most iconic parts of the Matterhorn today was added in 1978 when the Abominable Snowman, which we all Harold. Affectionately refer to as Harold, was added to the attraction.
It's crazy to me to think that Harold wasn't always there.
It is weird,
isn't
it?
He's such a big part of that attraction now. Actually, the first time we went to Disneyland, he was the reason I did not go on that attraction because I
was afraid of Harold.
this is also the girl that the first time she went on the Haunted Mansion cried, and like a cast member thought I needed to be like excused from the ride because I was having such a breakdown.
Wow.
Yeah, in the elevator, which my aunt was like, oh, it's not scary. And then, oh, there's my way, and there's the guy hanging. So yeah, that didn't really, that didn't really help, but I survived, and now it's my favorite attraction. And same thing with the Matterhorn. It's one of my favorite attractions.
Yeah.
But totally get it. I was 100% that kid that was terrified of these things. And now the new animatronics they have for Harold are awesome.
Really nice.
I feel like the Harold before, you could very easily miss him if you weren't paying attention because you just kind of zoom past him and he was just kind of there.
Now he's around a few times.
Well, and the, how, where they have him placed, you can't miss him because the one time you're coming like right, you know, you're coming right towards him, then turn right at the last second as he's trying to grab out at you. Very cool.
Now, we talked about with the Finding Nemo submarine voyage, we talked about the fact that they use some glass. So in the refurbishment from 2012 for the snow, they actually added glass beads that were mixed in so it actually reflects sunlight like actual snow does. Because before it was just paint.
Mm-hmm. It is beautiful, though. The mountain is very beautiful. It is, it's one of, it is probably second to the castle. I would argue that this is one of the most iconic Disneyland
things. Only one of them. It's there's literally only one.
It's, I mean, you know, when you think Disneyland, what do you think? I think the castle and I think of the Matterhorn. Now, sometimes I think about the Pixar Pal around. If I think DCA.
I also think of the Grizzly River Run because that was the icon of California Adventure when
it opened. To me, that one doesn't stick out as much as the Ferris wheel does. I don't know why.
That's true.
I think because there are so many other mountains in the Disney parks, it's just another mountain to me, whereas the Ferris wheel, that was different.
Now, you know, there's two tracks. Mm-hmm. There's a Fantasyland track and a Tomorrowland track. Mm-hmm. Do you have a favorite?
I think my favorite's the Fantasyland track. I was trying to remember this. Because one of them I got soaking wet on. I think it was the Tomorrowland one, and the other one I did not. So I think I'm going to say the Fantasyland track is my favorite. What's yours?
I think, let's see. It's probably the Fantasyland track. I think I'm with you, too.
That's, you know, and oddly enough, that's the one I've just so happened to get on the most times.
No, I'm wrong. It's the Tomorrowland track. Because I'm trying to think, because it's the what side you load on, right? Because if you're looking at it, the left side would be Tomorrowland, the right side would be Fantasyland. The left side.
Oh, so you like getting soaked?
I don't like getting soaked. I just think it's a, I feel like the Tomorrowland side is a little rougher of a ride, and I kind of like that. Because there's that one section where you're coming out and like you kind of drop. There's like kind of a drop that goes under another part of the track. And I like that. Because I feel like the Fantasyland, and actually it kind of makes sense. The Fantasyland side feels more like if you're not a huge coaster fan, that's a good side to go on because it's not as rough and tumble and drops and everything. But if you're a little more thrill seeker, do the Tomorrowland side because it gets you that drop. It shakes you around a little bit more. I don't know. I honestly, either side works for me. I like it, but I think I like the Tomorrowland side best.
Yeah, no, the big thing to me was getting soaked at the end.
Yeah.
Well, which I'm like, this isn't Splash Mountain. This is not Grizzly River one. Why am I sopping wet? I was sitting in the front. I don't know why I got, I don't know why, but yeah. Not fun.
Well, that's about all we're going to talk about the Matterhorn. If you want to know an in-depth thing about the Matterhorn, I would say go back to one of our older episodes where we talk all about the Matterhorn. Let's move on to the last one, which is probably one of my favorites. And that, of course, is
the... What do you mean, probably? It is one of your
favorites. Well, you challenged me earlier. Teresa, you guys who have been listening, you will know how hard of a question this was. Teresa said, oh, is it the monorail or... Like, is your favorite the monorail or is it the people mover?
Yes, if you had to choose one, which one?
I don't know. It's really
hard. That's a tough choice, I think, for you.
So the Disneyland monorail system, this was another one of those things that Walt saw somewhere and brought it back to the park. So he, it was the Disneyland Allweg monorail system because Allweg was the company that he first saw doing it and they worked with them to create the monorail, and it was the first daily operating monorail in the Western Hemisphere. And I think they still say that in the spiel as you're riding it.
I think, you know, it's such, to me, the monorail is so Walt. It's his love of trains, and then it's also his love of innovation and futuristic type things. I think it's, to me, it's very, very Walt.
It is very Walt. When it first opened, some people actually don't know this. When it first opened in 1959, all it did was kind of loop around Tomorrowland and gave you a little bit of view of parts of Fantasyland.
Yeah, it was 100% just an attraction.
Mm-hmm. Now, 2 years later, in 1961, they actually extended the track all the way out to the Disneyland Hotel, which then became a really kind of cool thing because, like, that's how you could get into the park. Now, as it is today, you can get on at Tomorrowland, and you can stay on when you get to Downtown Disney or the Disneyland Hotel back in the day. But when it gets back to Tomorrowland, you have to get off. Tomorrowland is everybody off. So you can't just ride at loops for days because that's where I'd be sitting. So there's been, so right as of now, there are three monorail cars. There's red, blue, and orange. When it first opened, there was only, in the Mark 1 trains, there was only two, and it was red and blue. And then when they did the Mark 2, they added another train, the yellow train, to add, you know, more capacity going out to the hotel. The Mark 3 came in 1968. They added another one. Monorail Green joined the fleet, and they were lengthened to be able to have five cars as opposed to the shorter cars from before. And then the Mark 4 monorail was actually built for Disney World. And then the Mark 5 monorail was the one that hung around for a really long time, starting in the early to mid 80s, and they were phasing out the old Mark 3s. And when I first went to Disneyland, these are the monorails I'm used to seeing. Even the Disney World monorails kind of look like this now, still. And so that stayed for a really long time. So mid 80s to 2004. And that's when they took Monorail Orange off the line and they took it to go be reverse engineered and everything to rebuild it while they were doing stuff with the Finding Nemo submarine voyage. And those became the Mark 7 monorails, which are the ones that you see today.
I think, you know, the thing that is, it's kind of controversial, but I like it, is every once in a while, and currently right now we have this, they put different wraps on the monorail. So looking back, the subs, actually, when the subs reopened for the Finding Nemo theme, they actually wrapped the monorails to make them look like subs. They put something kind of on the top. They made it look like a giant sub, basically. I think that's cool. For when Cars Land opened, they did a wrap to make the monorail look like it had eyes and a mouth, so much like the Cars characters. Currently, we have different Mickey wraps on the monorail to celebrate Mickey's birth, 90th birthday this year. And then last year when I was there, it was Pixar Fest themed. So it's, I hear mixed comments from people about the monorail being wrapped. They wish that the classic, what, you know, that it was classic all the time. I think the wraps are really cool. It makes it fun.
The wraps can be, I like them when they are done really well. Like I thought that the Cars ones looked really good. The Finding Nemo one looked pretty good too. I just don't like it when they do ones that seem just more like it's a billboard on the side. Like I like them when they're themed, like, oh, the monorail has a life now and is a car like Cars Land. Because then like, I feel like kids and stuff, they're like, oh, that's cute. Like it's alive. But I, as long as they stick with that kind of thing and less of billboard.
So you don't like the Mickey, like, does the Mickey feel like a billboard one to you?
No, because I think it was done really well.
Got it.
But I've seen ones where they've done, like, for different movies and stuff. I want to say that they did this with one of the Toy Story things where it just seemed like it was, like,
Advertising. Got it.
But I do enjoy,
like, Pixar Fest, when they had them Pixar themed. How'd you feel about that? There was a Finding Nemo one. There was a Incredibles themed one. I'm blanking on what the other one was.
I guess maybe I have a problem with the Disney World
one. It was Toy Story because, yes, it was the aliens were on one of the monorails. So we had the aliens, we had the Incredibles, and then we had Finding Nemo for the three for Pixar Fest. That's right.
I thought the Pixar Fest ones were done pretty well, actually. I guess I'm, now that I'm looking at it, I guess I'm remembering more of the Disney World ones. Cause like when Zootopia came out, it looked kind of like it was just a wrap. I mean, cause they added like little small characters at the bottom, that kind of thing. And then they had one for, what is this?
Iron Man.
Which that one actually looks pretty cool, but like Monsters University, I don't know. It just seemed like there was some that weren't as like classically done. The Mickey ones I think look really good because I think it goes really well with the like vivid colors of the new monorails that have that really cool reflective paint. Now, have you ever seen the maintenance tractor
come
out?
I have not seen it.
So, funny story. when Galaxy's Edge opened, they had a bunch of reporters there, and they you'd go and check in at Interventions, mm-hmm. and then you were kind of held by the monorail station before they like led you back to Galaxy's Edge.
Okay, sure.
And of course, it was early in the morning, and they cheered because they run the maintenance car around to check the track every morning, and people like cheered when it went by because they're like so maintaining. Yeah,
you have all these like Disney obsessed people,
right?
And they get to see a little sneak peek behind the scenes of the monorail. Like you and I for sure, you would have had to explain to me what it was. I probably would have been like, "Hey, what is that?"
Right?
Oh, that's this.
And now
we would have been cheering. Definitely.
The only time I've ever actually seen it was there was one time when for whatever reason we were there at the park and I went over by the front gates and it was late at night. Like mm-hmm. everybody was gone. The parks were closed, and for some reason I was able to walk over there at like 1 a.m. And they had it go by, and it had a bunch of lights on it so they could look at the track and everything. So I remember seeing that. They also sometimes bring it out if they have, like, a failure, because run on diesel, so it doesn't... So if the track loses power, mm-hmm. it goes out and tows them. I'm just thinking about how sad it looks towing a monorail.
Oh.
You know, it's like sometimes when the Columbia has an incident during, like, Fantasmic, and one of those little boats has to come out, like, yeah. push it. I just get kind of sad about that, but...
Loses the magic a little bit.
I love the monorail. I am excited to ride it again when we go from our hotel room. We'll get to see it go by. It's going to be so exciting.
Very exciting.
And you like the new colors? Like the cool, like, little reflective?
I think I do. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I think I do. They're very vivid.
Yeah.
I like that they're more color than not color, whereas before it was a lot of white with just a little bit of color.
Yeah. Yeah. It was just, for me, it was just like a nostalgia thing because it had been that way from when I was a kid. But I do like these ones. I do think they look really futuristic compared to the old ones. Mm-hmm. What I'm really excited to find out is there's rumors and rumors and rumors that the Disney World monorails are going to start getting replaced in like 2021. And I'm excited to see what that design
it's
looks like.
It's surprising to me that we have more up-to-date monorails than Disney World does.
Well, they have such a larger fleet to replace.
I suppose, but they are transportation there. Whereas ours, there's a debate. Is it an attraction or is it a mode of transportation? I'm on the attraction side. To me, it's an attraction.
I have to agree with you because it doesn't really go enough places.
Yes, I can get on and off of. Mm-hmm. But whereas Disney World, that is 100% a form of transportation.
Producer James, what do you think? Is the monorail at Disneyland an attraction or a form of transportation?
I would think the monorail at Disneyland is an attraction.
Yeah.
Because
why
only
do you
takes
ride the attraction? Do you ever ride it to get from point A to point B?
No, because I don't want to get off of it.
Yeah.
So I just
ride
it
to ride it. So that's why and it's a track.
I always feel like we miss out by not taking the monorail into the park some of the day.
But I want to go down Main Street.
It would be a wonderful way to like skip crowds on a busy morning.
That's true.
Taking the monorail in and just hopping off and get right at Space Mountain.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, maybe not your first day, but your second, third, fourth.
Maybe we'll have to test this theory if we
see how it works. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
We'll have to go get like breakfast over in downtown Disney or at the Disneyland Hotel.
Yeah.
Hop on the monorail.
Mm-hmm.
Away we go.
I think we did that. Didn't we do that once, James? Didn't we like eat in downtown Disney, then hop on the monorail and go back to the park instead of walking back through?
Oh, that makes sense.
We might have.
Yeah.
But I know for sure we at least took a loop on it. So.
Oh, yeah. Well, of course, it's the monorail. Well, I think that kind of does it. I mean, these are three iconic attractions that just... You know, have been present in the park 60 years. I guess we'll say it that way to be safe. Do you guys have any memories of these attractions? Do you have anything that we didn't talk about, or something that you have like a fun story of a visit that you had to the parks where you had some thing? Did you ever get evacuated from the subs?
I haven't.
Would love to hear your story. I will say that one attraction I would not want to be evacuated from is the monorail, because apparently, at least at Disney World,
scary.
You go out the top and you're supposed to slide down the front and walk on the beam. And I'm like, nope.
Yeah. That maybe if I'm feeling adventurous, but that's not my first pick for attractions or things to be evacuated from.
No, of course not. Pirates, I would say, is Pirates or Indy are probably my two top want to be evacuated from.
Indy.
Well, if you enjoy the show, please leave a review on iTunes or wherever you listen to your podcast. By leaving a review, it helps get our ranking better and allows the community to grow.
Well, we hope you enjoyed listening to this episode of DL Weekly. You can support the show for as little as 25 cents an episode. If you want access to our supporter chat that we always talk about, it's just 75 cents an episode. So please consider joining supporters like Kristen M. and head over to dlweekly.net/support.
Well, now it's time to return to James and Trivia Land to get answers to this week's trivia.
Oh, I am so excited. I'm excited about these answers. These were great questions. Thank you guys for sending them in.
Thank you, Dylan H., Jeremy J., and Ryan H. for your questions. Thank you, Dylan, for coming up with a cool new kind of way to do the trivia. So let's see how good we did.
Yeah.
Or bad.
Terrible.
So that new kind of question is the one we start with. Dylan provided me with an audio clip from an attraction somewhere in the resort, and you needed to tell me where it's from.
So I said from King Arthur's Carousel.
And I said Casey Jr.
And you two were both so on the right track.
Oh, no.
It is indeed a dark ride, but you're in the wrong park. It's Mike and Sully to the rescue.
Really?
Ooh.
Yes.
What scene is that from, or is it from a
scene? We're going to have to watch the POV. A POV video on that, because I'm very curious.
Yeah,
it's what I tell you. We're probably in the wrong park.
Yeah.
You're right. Yeah, it's
good.
Towards the end.
That was a stumper. Good one. Good one, Dylan. Thank you.
That is a good one, yeah.
Yeah, he definitely chose well. So, second question. James is lost in the park again. Help find me. I hopped on the Disneyland Railroad from the main entrance and almost completed the full circle tour, but was afraid to see the primeval world, so I got off before it. I walked west, thankful I wasn't stuck in all that traffic. To my right, I took my first left, kept walking, not ready for another adventure. I decided to pit stop for some food. Where am I likely eating?
Tomorrowland Terrace, I think we both agreed on.
You should know better. If I'm in that part of the park, I'm probably going to Alien Pizza Planet.
Oh!
Dang! That was my guess, but I didn't think that was west.
They're next to each other, so.
Yeah.
Well, sort of. Across from each other, but yeah. But it is called Tomorrowland Terrace, because for some reason I thought it was called... What is it called?
Tomorrowland Terrace anymore. It is the...
The Galactic Grill.
Oh, Galactic Grill.
Yeah, but it used to be Tomorrowland Terrace. Yep, nope, no points. Galactic Grill is what they turned it to, but it was called the Tomorrowland Terrace at one point. So...
Yeah, you deviated from the path.
Dang, we need to be in the park right now.
Why, is it all low weights for everything?
Yes.
Question three.
From Jeremy J., a two-part question. In honor of June being Pride Month at the Disney parks, there is the unofficial Gay Days. How long has the event been running, and why are participants encouraged to wear red?
Well, I'll do the second part first, because we both agreed that it was probably AIDS awareness. Mm-hmm. How are we on that one?
Wrong.
Ooh.
What is it?
That would be a good reason.
It does not mention AIDS awareness at all, though that is probably a good reasoning behind the choice. No. They pick red. Because red stands out in a crowd, because the park is open to everyone, it's easiest to identify one another if we're all wearing the same color. And while they don't consider it a political event in any sort of way, sea of red shirts does make a lasting impression on those who see it.
So I was right if I wouldn't have changed my answer.
Wouldn't have changed your answer.
Okay, and then the first one, I think Teresa went with, what, 25?
25 years.
And I went with 2001 or 18, I think is what that ended up calculating out to.
So Teresa's 1 year closer, so I'm going to give her the point. It's 22 years. They started
22.
1998.
Teresa's
close enough that it's worth a point to me.
Okay.
She's three away.
I'm in the side eye over here.
All right, and your last question from Ryan H. Which Disney Pixar film features a soundtrack clip from The Haunted Mansion?
We both went with Inside Out.
And you're both right.
Yes!
It's a point. Yeah, there she is.
You know, I didn't know that. That was an educated guess.
It's like...
Well, because it said Nightmare, and I'm like, nothing... I can't think of anything where you're in somebody's mind except for Inside Out.
It is super subtle.
I gotta watch this.
You got twice the amount of points as I did.
What a fun week. I'd love to ask more of your questions next week. My email is trivia@dlweekly.net.
Well, we will be back next week with more Disneyland news and information.
So until then, go out and enjoy the parks.
Ladies and gentlemen, Disneyland has now ended its normal operating day. We hope you've enjoyed your visit to the Magic Kingdom and that you'll be back with us again soon.